Morning, everybody. Welcome to this new message. Before we begin, let's commit this meeting, this message to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Your word is truth. And we pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would reveal your truth to us today through this message in Jesus' name. To your glory. Amen. Okay, praise the Lord. Well, today's message I've called To the Obedience of Christ. To the Obedience of Christ. Turn with me, if you will, to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And we're going to read from verse 1. Through to verse 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 to 7. Okay, verse 1. Now, I, Paul, myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am base amongst you, but being absent am bold towards you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringeth into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Do ye look on things after the outward appearance? If any man trust to himself that he is Christ's, let him himself think again, that as he is Christ's, even so are we Christ's. Praise God for his word. The words of the Apostle Paul there to the church in Corinth in his second letter to them. Now it can seem very difficult in the face of so much going on around us to keep focused upon the things of God. It's hard, isn't it, to really focus on God in these days when there is so much going on around us in the world and indeed in our own nation here in the United Kingdom. As believers in Christ, we may indeed have wonderful fellowship when we gather together on our regular church services. However, we live for 7 days a week, and 6 of those days are spent very much immersed in the ordinary, mundane and everyday things of this world. And even though you may put on a brave face when you do fellowship with other believers, how do you really feel? Now you'll often hear it said that Christianity is a way of life and not a religion. And you know, this is in fact a true statement. It is a way of life. Sometimes though, it can seem like we are trying to live two very different lives at the same time. One life as a Christian and one life as someone in the world. But this is not how it's supposed to be, brethren. And this is the very reason I believe the Lord placed this message on my heart for today. What we're going to look at today together is how we can live an ordered, obedient, and disciplined life in Christ in this dark, confused, and wicked world. Now, the first clues that we have to the ability to live this disciplined life comes from the Apostle Paul himself in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3, as follows, as we've already read. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. Now, this sentence by the apostle may not immediately seem to bring us much in the way of clarity on this subject. However, if we take a closer look at the original Greek wording used, I think it will shed more light upon what it means. Now, the words that have been translated for us into English, though we walk, in the verse, 2 Corinthians 10, chapter 3, though we walk, is in fact one Greek word, and that is peripateo. Peripateo. And this word means the following, and this is according, all these definitions are according to the Greek dictionary. First, it means to walk. It's obvious, isn't it? To make one's way, to progress, to make due use of one's opportunities, to regulate one's life, to conduct oneself, to pass one's life, to go through our life, as it were. Now, the words the flesh, which says, for though we walk in the flesh, the words in the flesh are again one Greek word, and it is sarx, sarx. Now, this word has the following meaning. It means literally the skin, the meat of our body, the body itself. In other words, our natural self, our natural person, as we stand or sit or walk. The word war is an interesting Greek word. The translation gives a slightly misleading sense, I think, to the actual word used, which is stratumahi, stratumahi. Now, this Greek word has the following meaning. It means to serve in a military sense, to execute the duties and functions of a soldier, however arduous, to live as a soldier, to contend with carnal inclinations. Interesting, isn't it? So then what Paul is explaining to the Corinthian church in this verse is that although we are still very much living in the same human body and very much still in this world, doing the everyday mundane things as a human being, we should not still be living a life governed by the old nature. In other words, not governed by the same lusts, desires, and emotions of the flesh that we had in our old life. We should rather be living as disciplined members of the body of Christ, soldiers, if you will, in a new army, learning to live in complete obedience to Christ and the Word of God, as a soldier does to his or her commanding officers, being trained and ready for any call upon our service. Now, we come to the conflict. The war, which Paul is talking about in verse 4 of our text. This conflict, this war, is not with other people. It is rather a conflict of inner natures. The old nature and the new nature. It is a constant, ongoing battle between the thoughts and inclinations of the old fallen and sinful nature and that of the imparted new nature of the risen Christ. Paul goes on to say in verse 4, as We read together. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Now, Paul here sets out the very nature of this warfare, this conflict, and also our enemy's focus. Remember, we are to be disciplined as soldiers in obedience to Christ. We need now to look closer at the wording used by Paul in this verse, in verse 4. And I'm going to go through the particular words before we come to the explanation, so that you understand more deeply what Paul is saying in the original language. Now, weapons in our verse is actually the Greek word hoplon, which means utensils or tools. It's a bit different to a machine gun, isn't it? It's not a weapon of warfare as such, but rather tools or utensils that we've been given. Warfare, in our verse, is the word strateia, which means service or career, as with the military. The word carnal in our verse is the word sarkikos, meaning pertaining to the flesh, pertaining to the body, or unregenerate flesh, the old person, the old nature. The word mighty in our verse is the word donatos, and that means powerful, capable, strong. And the words the pulling down is a one Greek word, and that is katharesis, which means demolition, the destruction, extinction of. And the words of strongholds is again one word, and that's acharoma, and that means to fortify, holding safely as a castle, anything one relies upon or hopes in. So then, bringing this all together, I hope that you can now see that Paul is here speaking about the believer, that is you and I, in Christ, using the tools that have been given us through the finished work at Calvary by the impartation of the Holy Spirit to overcome the works of the enemy, the devil, Satan, and his hordes, to ensnare us into obeying the old lusts and desires of the old fallen nature. Just how, though, does this work in practice, you might ask? Well, Paul goes on to tell us in the next verse. Let's read it together. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now, there's the title of our message. Bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. That's our aim. Here again, let's take a closer look at the Greek words used in this particular verse, verse 5. Casting down, two words there translated for us from one Greek word, and that is katharo, which is the root word of our previous word used for pulling down, which was Catharsis. Terrible pronunciation, please forgive me. Catharsis. It's the root word of that meaning, so it has the same meaning. Let's reprieve that again. Catharsis means demolition, destruction, or extinction of. And so we have casting down, which has the same meaning, pulling down, destruction, demolition. Now the word imaginations is the Greek word logismos, meaning computations, reasoning, conscience, thoughts, ideas. Now the words that exalt itself is one Greek word again, and that is epeiro, which means to raise up, exalt self, and so on. It's pretty self-explanatory, that one. Now the word knowledge is gnosis, which means act of understanding or understanding of God. And we get that understanding by reading his word, don't we? And allowing the Holy Spirit to reveal to us through our life experience and through the word of God. And knowledge, an understanding of God. It's the act of understanding of God. Bringing into captivity is again one Greek word. And it's eikmalotsio. And that means to make captive, to be led away captive, to captivate one's mind even. To captivate one's mind. That's an interesting phrase, isn't it? And the word obedience, this is the Greek word hupako, and that means compliance, submission. Obedience rendered to anyone's counsel, and obedience shown in observing the requirements of Christianity. These, I again restate that these definitions are from the Greek dictionary. An obedience shown in observing the requirements of Christianity. That's hupako. Now all of this simply means that we are to use the knowledge and understanding of the Word of God and what he has already achieved in and through us as believers in our Christian walk to overcome the way we used to think and act. We should now be walking in a new reality, a new life in and through the Lord Jesus Christ. This sounds all very well and good, doesn't it? But how can it be achieved in real life? Well, let's now look at the practical outworking of what Paul is saying here. First and foremost, we must remember and also keep fixed in the forefront of our minds that we are no longer of this world. We are in this world, but we are not of it. We have been made anew, haven't we? We've been regenerated, changed by and through our faith in the finished work of Calvary and our sincere repentance. I hope that your repentance was sincere, brethren. Our sincere repentance from our old sinful life in this world. We are not, therefore, to submit any longer to the things of the flesh, that being the old life, the old nature, the old lusts, desires, and so on and so on. However, the old nature with its lusts and desires is the very ground upon which the devil and his hordes can gain a foothold in our life, if we do not fit ourselves with every single piece of armour that God has provided through the Lord Jesus Christ and by his Holy Spirit. Any addictions, lusts, habits or desires that we had prior to our salvation, prior to our regeneration, will indeed be used by the devil once again to entice us away from the true path and our place before God in Christ. This is the warfare. This is the campaign to which Paul is referring to in our text today. It is not, and I underline not, a campaign or a struggle with or against other people. It is rather the continual struggle against the wiles of the devil to lure us and to entice us back into and under the ways of acting and thinking that were of the old nature, the old life, the unregenerated life. The nature, by the way, which we said and demonstrated when we first repented our sin and sinful life privately, then went through the waters of baptism publicly. We repented of all those things privately and publicly when we came to confess our sin with repentance to God privately, and then we went publicly through the waters of baptism, publicly expressing what had been done internally. Jesus gave us a perfect example of this common warfare or conflict that is recorded for us in Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 13. We're not going to read that now, but you can read that again in your own private time. That was the temptation of Christ Jesus, the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness. He was led into the wilderness by the Holy Spirit to be tempted in all ways as any other man. And he used the word of God to repel the temptations of the devil. Read that again, brothers and sisters. Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 13, the temptation of Jesus. A perfect example of overcoming the wiles of the devil. This, though, is why Paul re-emphasizes his point yet again to the church in Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 18, speaking of the armour of God. He does this after a long discussion about the importance of living a life worthy of the calling to which we have been called. And Paul is going through this from Ephesians chapter 4 through to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, before he goes on to speak of the armour of God. Brethren, it is sheer folly to think that we are all alone in our troubles and tribulations. We are not alone, as we should learn from the following verse. Turn with me, if you will, to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13. There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful. Underline that word faithful in your Bible. God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will, with the temptation, also make a way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. Amazing, blessed, promising words there by the Apostle Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit. And we've all been given all the equipment we will ever need in order to repel and to overcome any and all attempts of the devil to entice us away from the true faith and the true path. So what then do we do? Well, as the Americans put it, let's see where the rubber meets the road. Paul uses the analogy of the armour of a Roman soldier for a reason, brothers and sisters, in Ephesians chapter 6. Remember, the words used in the Greek are military terms. They describe the life responsibilities of any true soldier. He or she is highly trained and disciplined for that life, for that calling, because they may be called into service at any time. And so it is with us. They are trained to obey orders immediately and without question. They are trained how and when to use their weapons and to keep those weapons in good order. And as members of the body of Christ, we are also members of his army, if you will. We are his disciples. And the very word disciple in the Greek is mathetes, which means a learner, a pupil. This is why Paul uses the following words in Ephesians 6, verse 4. Read with me, if you will, Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 4. And you, fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Now, in this verse, Paul uses the words the nurture, or it's translated into the words the nature, which are actually one Greek word, and that is paideia. And that means tutorage. And that is education or training. By implication, it means disciplinary correction, chastening, chastisement, instruction, nurture. It's what you would expect in a classroom or on the training ground of an army. In other words, the word mathetes or disciple is one who is being paideia or trained. Do you see? The disciple is one who is being discipled or disciplined. Mathetes is disciple, and it is one who is being paideia or trained or disciplined. I hope this all makes sense to you. I'll read the verse again and you'll hopefully understand. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Paul is saying, older ones in the Lord, people who have been saved for a longer time, must help to train those coming up who are new in the Lord. Do you understand now? I hope this all makes sense to you. However, in order for either the soldier or indeed we as the disciples of Christ to be ready, we must first have on the armour that we've been freely given. This gives us a readiness should an unexpected attack occur. Now, you really don't want to be running around here and there scrambling to find and put on the armour when attack is already in progress, do you? A soldier wouldn't want to be looking around for his rifle or grenades or anything else that he has, his bayonet or whatever, if the enemy was already attacking him, would he? You need to already have them in preparedness. And next, you will need not only the offensive weapons, but also the defensive ones too. You'll also need the ability to use them, and also the willingness to use them. You may have the weapons, but are you willing to use them? You may or may not have noticed, as you have read through, or maybe you haven't read through, Ephesians 6 about the armour of God. You may not have noticed that there is no armour for the rear or the back of the disciple or the soldier. This is simply because we're meant to face and overcome any attack of the enemy, just as Jesus did, trusting completely in his and our Heavenly Father. Now we're going to look for a moment at the items of armour. I know we haven't read Ephesians 6 where it lays out the armour, but here they are. I've got them in order. There are seven pieces, seven being a perfect number. Number one, we have the loins girt with truth. Number two, we have the breastplate of righteousness. Number three, we have the feet shod with the readiness of the gospel. Number four, we have the shield of faith. Number five, we have the helmet of salvation. Number six, we have the sword of the Spirit, which the word tells us is the word of God. The sword of the Spirit, the word of God. And finally, number seven, we have prayer. All those seven pieces there make up the complete armour that God has given us through Christ Jesus by his Holy Spirit in our salvation. So then, let's look at each one in more detail. First of all, we have the loins girt with truth. Now, the loins are the part of the body concerned with reproduction normally. Those who hear the word of the gospel and believe will be saved. Not maybe, they will be. We will reproduce after our own kind. This is a biblical principle, unchanging biblical principle. All of God's creatures reproduce after their own kind. And we, as new creations in Christ, are to reproduce after our kind, spiritually. So it must be the true gospel, the gospel of truth. Secondly, we have the breastplate. Now, the breastplate protects the heart within the chest. We must protect and nurture the righteousness of Christ that has been imparted to us. Turn with me, if you will, quickly to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 8. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 8 says this: But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for an helmet, the hope of salvation, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. Next, number three, we have the feet shod. Excuse me, just clearing my throat. The feet shod, to protect our walk with Christ and to help us adhere to the gospel and live by it, thus enabling us to walk unhindered in the way. We need our feet shod with the preparedness of the gospel to protect our walk with Christ and to help us adhere to the gospel and live by it, thus enabling us to walk unhindered in the way. Number four, we have the shield of faith. The shield of faith. Now, scripture tells us that without faith, it is impossible to please God. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Underline, impossible. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. The shield helps us to repel from whatever direction those things that would cause us to stray from the straight and narrow way, by enticing us away from the truth, enticing us away from the things that we know to be true, from the straight and narrow way that has been set before us. This is the victory over the world, etc. By using the shield. Next, we have the helmet of salvation. Number five. This protects the mind, thus putting on the mind of Christ, having and maintaining the blessed hope of our salvation. Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3. Isaiah 26, verse 3 says this: "They will keep in perfect peace." They will keep him, rather, in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. Doesn't that sum up the helmet of salvation? Protecting the mind, because God will keep in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on him, because he trusts in thee. Number six, the sword. This is the word of God. We therefore reject, resist, and uncover lies, deception, and so on with the truth of the word of God, just as Jesus did in Matthew 4, verses 4 to 10. Or as we saw earlier in Luke, the temptation of Jesus, using the word of God back against the devil, who is trying to twist it. And finally, we have prayer, number seven. This final piece interlocks and intertwines all the other pieces of the armour. It is the vital, close relationship with the Godhead, from which we draw the help and strength to maintain the effectiveness of the armour. So, to conclude, to bring all this together, what does it all mean? What are we supposed to learn? Well, brothers and sisters, I'm aware that there's been a lot of detail in word study in this message, but it's been necessary for us to see the importance of just what the Apostle Paul was teaching both the believers in Corinth, but also us who follow them. The Apostle Paul knew well that persecution, tribulation, was sure to come upon the believers in Corinth. Indeed, Jesus himself had promised that persecution or tribulation was sure to come to all true believers in this world, because we are, or supposed to be, different to the world around us, aren't we? We're not of the world, but we're in the world. Let's read for a moment from the Gospel of John, chapter 16. The Gospel of John, chapter 16, verse 33. John chapter 16, verse 33. These things I have spoken unto you. This is Jesus himself speaking. These things I have spoken unto you. And who is you? You is whomever are hearing this message who belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. That in me, that is Jesus Christ, in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, trouble. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Hallelujah. Now the crux of this message today, brethren, is locked within this verse. John 16, verse 33. Jesus himself stated that it is a certainty, that persecution or tribulation will come to all who truly believe in and follow him. Because it is through this world and the things of this world and the old nature, remember, that the devil, Satan, works. The answer, however, lies in the fact that Jesus overcame this world. Underline that word, overcome, in John 16, verse 33. Jesus said, I have overcome the world. Jesus overcame this world. So then, the only way to overcome the world for us and the things of the world is being in Christ Jesus, isn't it? The only way for us to overcome the things of the world, the things of the old nature, is for us to be in and securely in Christ Jesus, having on the full armour that will be our protection. As Paul states in his second letter to the Corinthian church, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. The actual Greek word means creation, a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Hallelujah. What a wonderful God we serve. Being in Christ, being secure in an ongoing and close relationship with the risen Christ, and therefore being clothed with the full armour that we have so closely studied today, is the only way to be sure of overcoming any and all attacks of the devil, Satan. This is why, brothers and sisters, I have called this message to the obedience of Christ. Because unless we are willing to forsake the things of this world, things of the old nature, and trust and obey the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ, and have a close relationship with him through prayer and scripture reading, we will not have the protection of the armour against the wiles and ways of the devil. And we will most certainly fail and fall in this conflict. So, to close this message, I want us to read together from Revelation chapter 12, verse 11. Revelation chapter 12, verse 11. And this is important for us to understand and believe. Revelation 12, verse 11. This at the end of all things, and the church victorious, being raised up to be with the Lord. Revelation 12, verse 11 says this, and they, that is the church, the true believers, overcame him, that is the devil, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. They overcame him, that is the devil, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. Now let us not forget that the word of our testimony will depend upon just how much we really trust and obey the Lord Jesus Christ and his word, because our testimony is our life in this world and what Christ has done in us and through us. And he can only do that if we trust him and obey him. I'll say it again. Let us not forget that the word of our testimony will depend upon just how much we really trust and obey the Lord Jesus Christ and his word. Now, brethren, it is my earnest desire that all those who believe in him, in the Lord Jesus Christ, in these the last days, will be found secure in their salvation. That you, the listener, will be found secure in your salvation. To do so, we must trust in the Lord, obey his word, and be found always in the full armour that has been given to us, being ready and willing to resist the devil and to repel any and all attempts to draw us away from the true path, thus bringing all things to the obedience of Christ. Until next time, brethren, may God bless you richly. Amen.